Breathing in, I know that my Sangha is still there around me, breathing with me. Breathing out, I smile to my Sangha. My Sangha is not exactly outside of me. She is inside of me, and I can bring her home. Dear Sangha, today is Monday, October the 10th, the year 2011. We are on our sixth day of the retreat, the last day of our retreat with the team Stepping into Freedom, Savoring Life. The first human being who stepped on the moon, his name is Neil Armstrong, an American astronaut. It was in 1969. And he was very mindful when he made the first step on the moon. Very mindful. He pronounced a kind of mantra when he made his first step on the moon. The mantra went like this: this is a small step for a man, but a giant leap for mankind. And as part of mankind, we made a step with him, the first step with him on the moon. We know now that there is no trees in the moon, no water, no grass, no animals. And many of our scientists who spend time on sky labs, 6 months or so, are very glad to go home to the Earth, our homeland. It's so beautiful down here. The creek, the river, the forest, the trees, the birds. Everything is beautiful. Everything seems to belong to the kingdom of God, the Pure Land of the Buddha. And the earth is our true home. I do not look for home elsewhere. I always recognize Earth as my home. And I see that the Earth is our mother, very compassionate, loving, beautiful mother. We are daughters, sons of Mother Earth, all of us. We have manifested from our mother, and we will come back to our mother. She's already there in order to welcome us back, in order to help us manifest again and again. We continue always. Our nature is nature of no birth and no death. And the sun is really our father. Without the sun, there will be no life on earth. And we are also sons and daughters of the sun, in a real sense. Without the heat, without the light provided by our Father and the Son, there's no life possible on earth. And the Son is not just outside of us, and He is inside of us. And to me, the Son is a great Bodhisattva, a Buddha. A Buddha does not have to be in a human form. Humans are very young species on earth. And Buddhas do not have to be a human being. Buddhas can be a star, a planet, a constellation, and so on. And they are there available. And we can get in touch with Buddhas and Bodhisattvas in this very moment. The planet Earth is a beautiful Bodhisattva. She is our mother, a real mother that we can touch and embrace every day. Many of us are looking for a holy mother elsewhere, in the sky. But we have a real mother here. This is not an idea. This is not an abstract thing. She is a real. And our mother is not outside of us. She is inside us. We are all daughters and sons of our mother. And when you practice mindful walking, we kiss our mother with our feet. And every step can bring joy, the joy of being alive, the joy of having contact with all wonders of life in the here and the now. And walking meditation is a wonderful way, a pleasant way of practice, so that you can be fully alive at each moment. And walking on the planet Earth is a miracle, it is a wonder. The Zen Master Lin Chi said, the miracle is to walk on Earth, not on fire, or on thin air. And when we practice mindful walking, we perform the miracle of walking on Earth every time. Like Neil Armstrong, we should be very mindful of our steps. Every step may be the first step. Every step helps understanding joy, peace, happiness to be born. Just touching the earth, our mother, with the mindfulness, and joy is born, happiness is born, and we are free from worries, fear, and other kind of afflictions. So please, dear friends, brothers and sisters in the practice, when you go home, bring the practice of mindful walking home. Remember, every step can be joyful. Every step can be healing. Every step can be happiness. We should not look for happiness elsewhere, outside of this planet. We should not look for happiness in the past or in the future. It is possible in the here and the now. That is the teaching of the Buddha. Happiness is possible now. And if we make a step mindfully on earth, our mindfulness and concentration may help us transcending time. Time is somehow a product of our mind. We distinguish between the past, the present, and the future, as if the past is outside of the present, and the present is outside of the future. That is dualistic thinking. That is discrimination. In fact, if we touch reality deeply in the present moment, we touch eternity. Eternity can be touched in an instant. And it's possible to transcend time, to be free from time, from the past, present, and future, by touching the present moment. When we touch the present moment deeply, we touch the past, the future, we touch eternity. And we transcend birth and death, being and non-being, coming and going. So mindfulness of walking can bring a lot of joy and can bring also the highest enlightenment. Because when you get free from time, you transcend time, you transcend all worries and fear and anxiety. So the practice of mindful breathing and mindful walking, if it is done deeply, it is a very deep practice. It's it's a practice that can bring the ultimate reality to us, the final enlightenment. It's not for beginners only. I trust that all my friends will bring the practice of mindful walking home and enjoy every moment of your daily life, touching our mother, the planet Earth, our father, Sun, with every step, and find happiness, the joy of living, the happiness of being alive every moment. This is possible for everyone. When I was a novice monk, my teacher taught me how to bow to a Buddha. Before you bow to the Buddha, you have to meditate. If you don't, the bowing, the touching of the earth will not have any effect. Because to touch the earth, to bow to the Buddha, is to establish communication, communion between you and the Buddha. And the practice of concentration called emptiness, no self, can help you to bow in such a way that communication, communion is possible between you and the Buddha. And my teacher gave me a verse to learn by heart, so that every time I bow to the Buddha, I may use it with mindful breathing before I bow. This morning we practiced that. Before touching the earth, before Shakya Muni Buddha, we chanted that verse, the one who bows and the one who is bowed to. Both of them are empty in their nature. It means, dear Buddha, you are made of non-you elements. You are empty. Your nature is empty because as a Buddha, you are made of non-Buddha elements. And myself, who is bowing to you, I am also made of non-me elements. I am also empty in my nature. It means that you are made of non-you element. And in the non-you element, there is me in you. And I am also made of non-me element. And including this non-me element, there is you. So the fact that is that I can see you in me and I am in you. And before you touch that nature of emptiness in you and in the Buddha, you should not bow. Because if you have not touched that nature of emptiness in you and the Buddha, well, you and the Buddha are two separate entities. There's no communication, no real communication possible. And because you are made of non-you element, including me, and I am made of non-me elements, including you, that is why communication is very deep. And the verse went like that. The one who bows and the one who is bowed to, they are both by nature empty, and that is why communication is very deep. And that kind of insight of interbeing help us transcend the notion of self. Self is a notion, not a reality. Because everything is changing. You are not the same person in two consecutive moments. No one can swim twice in the same river. Not only the swimmer is not the same, but the river isn't the same either. And meditation on impermanence, the concentration, the samadhi on impermanence, bring about the insight of no self. Yesterday there was a question about how to get in touch with the person who has already died. I am really talking to her, or I just imagine I am talking to her. And in the answer, I remember there is the practice suggested as you look at your picture as a 5-year-old boy or girl. And you try to talk to that five-year-old boy or girl that was you. You know that five-year-old boy has not died. That five-year-old girl has not died. It has just become, because things are impermanent. The little boy, the little girl has grown into an adult. And you are the continuation of that little boy or little girl. Can you truly talk to the little boy or the little girl? The little boy or that little girl is a reality or just a notion? You are talking to a reality or you are talking to a notion? And if you can talk to that little boy, you can talk to the person who has died. In fact, she has not died. She has grown into a form that may not be familiar to you. She's always there. And if we do not have the insight of impermanence of non-self, we cannot get in touch. And if we can get in touch, we can truly communicate with him or her. We cannot say that Shakyamuni Buddha has died. No. We can be in touch with his continuation in the here and the now. When you see someone walking mindfully and generating the energy of peace and joy, well, that's Shakyamuni Buddha. That is a continuation of Shakyamuni Buddha. And when you enjoy breathing in and release all the tension in your body, well, Buddha Shakyamuni is in you. It's not an idea, it's not an abstract idea, it is a reality. And you can get in touch with Buddha Shakyamuni at any time you want. With mindfulness, concentration, and insight. Because Shakyamuni, his nature is no birth and no death, just like our cloud. And you also, you are of a nature of no birth and no death. And the person you think that has died, her nature is also the nature of no birth and no death. And with that insight of impermanence, no self, no coming, no going, no birth, no death, you can still get in touch. And when you want to touch the earth before the Buddha, the future Buddha, the Buddha of love, Maitreya, and you say that I'm touching the earth before the Buddha who is to be born. But you already know that a cloud is free from birth and death, being and non-being. A cloud is free from being and non-being, birth and death. And why do you talk about the birth of a Buddha? A Buddha is also free from birth and death. And you don't have to wait for the Buddha to be born. He is already there. And you can be in touch with the future Buddha in the here and the now. Maitreya is there. Every time you breathe in mindfully, you generate the energy of mindfulness, concentration, and insight. You are a cell in the Buddha body. You are Maitreya, you are the future Buddha. We can in touch with Maitreya at any time we want. The Sangha is a Buddha. It's like the sun is a Buddha. So everything is available in the here and the now. Every function as a cell in the body of the Sangha, the Sangha become the living Dharma, and the Sangha become the living Buddha. And that is very concrete. This is not an idea. Buddha, Dharma, Sangha are not ideas. They are reality that we can touch at any moment. You don't have to go to a temple in order to bow to the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. Anywhere, at any time, you can get in touch with the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. If you behave as a cell in the Sangha body, as a cell in the Buddha body, and then the Buddha is always available. And we need some training in order to get used to that kind of vision, that kind of insight. And we can take refuge in the three jewels at any moment. And do not have to pronounce the word, I take refuge in the Buddha. No. When you breathe in mindfully, generating mindfulness, concentration and insight, you are taking refuge in the Buddha. Because Buddha is mindfulness, concentration and insight. And if you have come from a Christian background, you can look at yourself and Jesus the same way. Jesus is available in the here and the now. You may get in touch with Him at any time you want. We talk about the living Jesus. It means that Jesus is available in the here and the now. And how? If you are a Buddhist practitioner, you may understand more easily the teaching of the living Christ. We know that Jesus is the Son of God and the Son of Man. Every Christian recognizes that He is both the Son of God and the Son of Man. So in Him there is the element God the Father. And mankind. And then the Holy Spirit in Him. Imagine Jesus without the Holy Spirit in Him. He is not Jesus. Imagine Jesus having no Father in Him, God the Father in Him. He is not Jesus. Imagine the element man is not in Jesus. He is not Jesus either. And that is the teaching of the Church. God the Father is in Him. God the Holy Spirit is in Him. Man is in Him. He is also made of no Him element, namely the Father, the Holy Spirit, and man. And if you don't see the emptiness of Jesus, you cannot get in touch with Him. Jesus is not an entity absolutely other than you. And you are in Him. And He is in you. That is why communication with Jesus is possible. So if you are a meditation practitioner, you can bow to Jesus that way. The one who worships and the one who is worshipped, their nature is empty. And that is why communication is inexplicable. And practicing Buddhist meditation, you become a better Christian. You understand Christianity deeper, and you have nothing to fear. In the Diamond Sutra, Vajracchedika Prajna Paramita Sutra, which is a very famous sutra in the tradition of Zen. The Buddha advised us to remove four ideas, four notions. Sign, tướng, nền sàng. The form, the sign, the appearance. We know that one of the three concentrations called the three doors of liberation is signlessness. So there are four signs we might get caught in, and we are prevented to touch the ultimate reality and get the insight. And the first sign is the sign of a self. There is no separate self. There is no absolute entity. A flower is made only of non-flower elements. And if you remove all these flower, non-flower elements, there is no flower left. And that means the nature of the flower is empty. Not only a flower is empty of a separate self, but a Buddha also. A Buddha is also empty, because a Buddha is made only of non-Buddha elements. And among the non-Buddha elements, there is suffering. Without suffering, you cannot make a Buddha. Without the mud, you cannot make a lotus flower. We know that understanding suffering brings about compassion. And compassion is Buddha. Thanks to the suffering, and thanks to the looking deeply into the suffering, that understanding arises. And understanding brings about compassion. That is why the mud is so essential for the arising of the lotus. Suffering is very essential as an element that is essential to the making of a Buddha. So looking into the Buddha, if you do not see the suffering that he has, she has undergone, you have not seen a Buddha yet. If you look into a Buddha, you only see Buddha and do not see non-Buddha element, you have not seen a Buddha yet. And if you have seen the non-Buddha elements in the Buddha, you are free from the first notion, the first sign, self. That is why the meditation emptiness is very crucial. And we know that emptiness does not mean non-being. In the Heart Sutra, it is said, form is emptiness. And emptiness is form. The Buddha is empty, but you cannot, the Buddha is not there. It's very clear in the Heart Sutra, form is emptiness. And emptiness is form. Thanks to emptiness, any form is possible. That is a very famous saying of Nagarjuna, a Buddhist practitioner in the 2nd century of our area. Nagarjuna, thanks to emptiness, everything is possible. Form does not differ from emptiness. Emptiness does not differ from form. Form is not other than emptiness, and emptiness is not other than form. So to be empty does not mean not to be there. If you believe that form is not there, you are caught in a notion of non-being. And if you believe that form is there, you are caught in a notion of being. And reality that ultimate transcends both notion of being and non-being, birth and death. And it is possible to apply this insight into daily life. This is not philosophy, this is life. So if we look into a self and see that the self is made only of non-self element, we are free from the notion of self. If we look into the Buddha and we see non-Buddha elements, we are free from the notion that Buddha is a self. In our body, the process of mitosis is happening every moment. A mother cell producing two daughter cells. Can you separate the mother and the daughter? The mother is in the daughter, and the daughter is in the mother. They are not two separate entities. The mother. When we look at a couple, father and son, it is the nature of emptiness of both. Looking deeply into the son, you see the father. If you have not seen the father in the son, you have not seen the son. You have not truly seen the son. A son is made of non-son elements, father also. Looking into the father, you see the son inside. So when you touch the reality of emptiness, of no self, in the father and the son, you no longer discriminate. You no longer believe that son and father are two separate entities. Son and father, they are not the same. They are not different reality either. The five-year-old boy, that was you, and you now. Are you the same with him, or a different person? The five-year-old girl, that was you, and you. Both of you are the same person, or two different persons? The Buddha said, neither the same nor a different person. We have to transcend notions of sameness and otherness. So this is a pair of opposites. The other pair is being and non-being. Another pair is birth and death. They look like a pair of opposites. But these pairs of opposites, both elements lean to each other in order to manifest, like the left and the right. They always go together. Like suffering and happiness. Looking into happiness, you have to see non-happy elements that have come together and produce happiness. Looking into suffering, you have to see non-suffering elements that have come together and produce suffering. When you drink your tea, you might put some sugar in it. And the easiest way to break sugar into its smallest elements is to put it on your hot tea. And with a spoon, the piece of sugar become molecules of sugar. It's so tiny that no filter can retain molecular sugar. It's sweet. But when you are capable of breaking the molecular sugar into atoms, and you can do that, you get a few dozens of carbon, atoms of carbons, a few dozens of atoms of oxygen, a few atoms of hydrogen. These three elements, none of them is sweet. The sweet is made only of non-sweet elements. Suffering is like that. Happiness is like that. Buddha is like that. Cloud is like that. Everything is like that. Everything is a composite thing. And we have the word formation to designate composite things. Samskara. The Chinese is Han. Every composite things, every formation is impermanent. This is a famous statement in Buddhist literature. Chư hành vô thường, chư hành vô thường. All formations are impermanent. Anitya, sattva, samskara. Every formation is impermanent. And because things are impermanent, they don't retain an absolute identity. They change all the time. No one can swim twice in the same river. And the river, even if we are the same person, the river is not the same river. And many sages have seen that. Not only the Buddha, but sage ones all have seen this, the reality of impermanence. And we know that the last four exercises of mindful breathing is about four kinds of concentration that help us to liberate. The 13 contemplation contemplating impermanence this is one concentration. And in every tradition of Buddhism, impermanence is a practice of concentration, samadhi. We all have an idea about impermanence. We know that things are impermanent. We accept the truth of impermanence, but we do not have the concentration of impermanence. Many of us who know perfectly what impermanence is and accept the truth of impermanence, but we still behave as if things are permanent. If you have the concentration of impermanence, when you look at your partner, you know that she is impermanent. And you are impermanent. And what you can do to make her happy today, you do it, because tomorrow may be too late. But many of us behave as if she is going to be there for 1,000 years. And if something happens, she's no longer there, we begin to cry, because we do not have the insight of impermanence. We only have the notion of impermanence. So a good practitioner is not satisfied with notions she got from a Dhamma talk. She practiced mindfulness and concentration in order to maintain that insight alive. And if that insight is alive in her, and then she behaves perfectly, and she will not regret in the future. If you know that your beloved one is impermanent, and you are also impermanent, you will not get angry at her and make her suffer. Just suppose someone is angry at his beloved, and the practice recommended to him is to close his eyes and visualize his beloved one 300 years from now. And it takes only a few seconds to touch the reality of impermanence and to see that it's not intelligent at all to get angry at her. And you cherish the time being together. And when you open your eyes, you treasure her presence and you want to hold her in your arms instead of trying to punish her by something, saying something strong. So the insight of impermanence is what we need, and not the notion of impermanence. And if we have the insight of impermanence, we have the insight of emptiness. And we also get the insight of signlessness. You are not caught by the idea of a self, because nothing is permanent. Everything is changing. And everything contains everything else. a flower contains the whole cosmos. And your beloved one contains the whole cosmos also. The sun, the moon, the planet Earth, everything. So the first sign, the first notion that the Diamond Sutra recommends us to remove is the notion of self. And you have a lot of freedom, a lot of liberty. That liberty, you cannot go to the street and demonstrate in order to get. That liberty is a result of deep looking meditation and removing the notion of self. You step into freedom. You are free from the complex of superiority, of inferiority, and of equality. Because you see no self to compare. You have the complex because you compare between two selves to see that one is higher, one is lower. And you, because you still compare, that is why you demand to be recognized as equal. But if you know that you are in him and he is in you, that you inter are, that both of you are empty and there is no self and you don't have to compare and you are free from three kinds of complexes. So in psychotherapy, low self-esteem is sickness. And the healing is try to to bring, promote the self, to bring it a little bit higher. That's not the fundamental way. But we have to see that the high self-esteem is also a kind of sickness. Low self-esteem brings a lot of suffering, but high self-esteem also brings a lot of suffering. You can make many people suffer and you suffer also. And also the complex of equality is not health. Only the big insight, the great insight, that everything contains everything else. Everyone is empty of separate self. And there will be no more comparison. And you get out of suffering. And you don't have to get recognition. Because you know that the whole cosmos is in you. The Buddha is in you. The constellation is in you. The sun, the earth is in you. You have no complex at all. And that is complete liberation. That is stepping into freedom. The removal of the notion self. When you bow to the Buddha, and if you know that the Buddha is everything, you are nothing. You are seeking for some compassion from understanding from the Buddha. You have the complex of inferiority. You think that you are only a living being, and he is a Buddha. And that is discrimination. That is wrong thinking, not right thinking. That is, you become a slave of the Buddha. If you bow to Buddha that way. But if you have touched the the nature of emptiness in you and in the Buddha. You are not a slave of Buddha anymore. You know that Buddha is in you and you are in the Buddha. Buddha is made only of non-Buddha elements, including you. So there is no discrimination. And if we try to apply it into our case, you and your partner, you and your father, you and your mother, you might believe that you are a different self and your partner is a different self. The son has a different self and the father has a different self. You are caught in that dualistic thinking. You have not touched the truth of interbeing. And that is why anger, fear, despair is still possible. You are in your partner, and your partner is in you. You have lived together several years. And there's a lot of you in her, and there's a lot of her in you. And when you speak of separation or divorce, you don't know that that is not possible. As far as the content is concerned, maybe the law can acknowledge there is a separation, but you can never get rid of her. She can never get rid of you. There's a lot of you in her. She carries you to forever, and you carry her forever. You have to recognize that. There's a better way. That the same thing is true with father and son. Father is in the son, and son is in the father. We have to touch the nature of emptiness in both. And with that insight of no self, we can transcend despair, separation, discrimination. So if there is a difference in the relationship between father and son, mother and daughter, husband and wife, partner and partner, we can apply the practice of emptiness and no self and get free from it. And we can live in peace and know how to transform our anger, our fear, our despair. Otherwise, even if the law allowed us to be separated, we still continue to carry the wounds for all our life because we cannot get rid of our non-us elements, including her. The second notion, the second sign we have to get rid of is the notion of man, purusha. We know that man is a very young species on earth. And we behave as if you are the boss, we are the boss here. We have done a lot of damage to our Mother Earth. And we want to safety, prosperity, happiness for man only, at the expense of other elements, non-man elements, like vegetal, animal, minerals. Man is made only of non-man elements. It's very clear. Without the mineral, the vegetal, and the animals, there's no man. If we remove all these non-man elements from us, we cannot continue. And yet you are trying to protect us by destroying our non-us elements. Many species have been destroyed. So you look into man and you see the non-man element, and you get the insight of interbeing, of emptiness, that wake us up, that give us the insight that we have to, in order to protect man, we have to protect non-man elements, namely the water, the air, the minerals, the earth, the vegetables, and the animals. And that is why the Diamond Sutra can be considered to be the oldest text on the teaching of deep ecology. And we are caught by the idea that God has the form, has a sign of a man. Like we have got caught that the Buddha can only be a human being. But in the beginning of this talk, we have told each other that the Buddha can be a star. There's a film, Jesus Superstar. And the son is a Buddha. And he, to me, he is Amitabha Buddha. But because Amitabha Buddha is the Buddha of infinite light and infinite longevity. The sun in its present form, it cannot be eternal. Any element, any formation is impermanent. The sun is a formation in the cosmos. The sun is impermanent also. Every second, the matter, the mass of the sun, some mass of the sun is converted into energy. And our sun is thinning every moment. Because the sun is in the process of transforming matter into energy. Light is made of photons, and photons have no mass. They are pure energy. And that energy is made of the matter, of the mass of the sun. And one day, although it takes a long time, the sun will disappear. And the sun will be only energy. Nothing is lost. One day, our body will disintegrate. But the energy of our actions in terms of thought, speech, and action will continue always. There is the law of the conservation of energy. Nothing is lost. There is the law called the law of the conservation of matter. No matter is lost. Matter can be converted into energy, and energy can be converted back into matter. When we bring one electron and one positron together, there will be a small explosion. And it produces energy. Gamma rays. So it is possible for matter to be converted into energy. And if we bring two gamma rays together, we can produce electron and positron also. So energy can be converted back into matter, and nothing is lost. When you observe a chemical reaction, you might have the impression that something disappears during the chemical reaction. But if we keep track, if we observe fully, we will find out that no atom is lost, and no new atom is gained. The entering mass before the reaction, and the exiting mass after the reaction, exactly the same. And that is why Lavoisier said, nothing is born, nothing died. There's no birth and no death. He did not practice Buddhist meditation, but he found the same thing, no birth and no death. The law of conservation of energy say that you cannot create new energy. You can only transfer energy to another form. And the law of conservation of matter say the same, you cannot create new matter. And you cannot destroy any matter. No birth and no death. This is confirmed by modern science. The only thing is that we should be able to apply that in our daily life, not just in technology. Neuroscience have discovered that there is no self in the brain. Neurons in our brain, they operate like a symphony, concerting. They communicate with each other in a wonderful way, and they produce thought, feelings, perceptions, and so on. It is a symphony, a concert, without a shift in an orchestra without a conductor. And the truth of no self can be found in that. No one is the boss giving the order to other neurons. No neuron play the role of president. And we should be able to apply that kind of insight found by science into our daily life. We can organize a sangha in such a way. There's no boss in the sangha. And in Plum Ridge, we try our best to operate like that. Every cell of the sangha knows what to do and what not to do in order to promote the well-being for the whole sangha. The monastics in this retreat, each of them has a function of helping with the retreat. And you have not seen any conductor, any boss giving order around. Each of us try to behave as a cell of Sangha. If we got enough information and we know what to do and what not to do in order to promote well-being for the retreat. And each of us, monastic or lay, are the same. And to some extent, we have been able to do that. And that is why there is a harmony, there is a joy, there is a well-being in a retreat. So man is made of non-man element. You have to see the nature of emptiness into being in man, and then we will step into freedom, and we avoid making a lot of suffering to us and to other species. freedom from suffering, freedom from fear. And the third notion, the third sign that we have to get it, is the notion of living being. Living being here is a sattva, a creature. As opposite to God, opposite to Buddha, because there is a distinction, a kind of complex, a kind of discrimination between us and the Buddha. If we don't know how to practice, we will revere the Buddha as a God, as an entity completely outside of us. Dear Buddha, you are happiness, you are freedom, you are love, and I am nothing at all. I am begging you for some wisdom, for some happiness, for some freedom. And that kind of worshipping, touching the earth, is not in the spirit of Buddhism. You have to see that the Buddha is made only of non-Buddha elements, including the element of suffering. You have to see the mud in the lotus in order to really see the lotus. And when you look at the mud, you can see future lotus. When you look at you, you can see a future Buddha. You have no complex of inferiority. You are not a slave of the Buddha. You are not even equal to the Buddha, because to think that you and the Buddha, you are equal, that is all already caught in the notion of self. You see you and Buddha is in you. You see the nature of interbeing between the Buddha and you. And you have to guard that kind of insight in order not to be caught in the dualistic thinking about Buddha and you, the creator and the creature. You cannot remove the Buddha from you. And you cannot remove you from the Buddha. The same thing must be true with the creator and the creature. The same thing is true with the mother self and the daughter self. The same thing is true with the father and mother and son. You cannot remove the father from the son and vice versa. And that is why in the Zen tradition, we speak of the non-duality between a living being and a Buddha. This stands for living being. This stands for Buddha. The non-duality between living being and Buddha. You have to see living being as being made of non-living being elements, and you have to see that Buddha is made of non-Buddha elements, so that you can see you in the Buddha and the Buddha in you, and you are free. You step into freedom. You are no longer a victim of the Buddha, a slave of the Buddha. In the Zen tradition, sometimes they say, when you go out, if you meet the Buddha, kill him. It means to kill the Buddha as a notion, that the Buddha is something other than us, outside of us. We may have a notion that the creator is totally outside of the creature. That is dualistic thinking. But to me, the flower that is there. If we have time. And to meditate means to have time to look deeply at what is there. If you have the time to get in touch with this wonder, we know that she belongs to the kingdom of God. And if we touch this flower deeply, we touch the kingdom of God. And if we touch the kingdom of God, we touch God. Because the kingdom of God and God, they are not different entities existing outside of each other. So God is available 24 hours a day. And with that kind of insight, touching God, being with God, resting in God is something possible at every moment of our daily life. God is inside. God is not an entity outside of us. The Creator is not outside of the creature. And that is why practicing Buddhist meditation can help you to be a deeper practitioner of Christianity. So the separation, the distinction between Creator and creature, Buddha and us, should be removed in order for communication to be possible, to be real. And the fourth notion that the Sutra of Diamond recommend that we remove is lifespan. We believe that there is a moment in time in which we are born, we were born, and there is another moment in time in which we will die. And we exist only from point B to point D. We did not exist before point B, and we will no longer exist after point D. And that is to be caught in the idea of a lifespan. We only are on this earth for a moment, a very short moment. We have passed from the realm of non-being into being, and we stay in the realm of being only for maximum 100 years. And we will pass through the realm of non-being again. And that is a notion called a lifespan we should remove. Because you are caught in the notion of being and non-being, birth and death. That's why you are caught in the notion of lifespan. Our nature is the nature of no birth and no death. We are free from birth and death. We are already free. We have to recognize that freedom. Because scientists like Lavoisier, they said that nothing is born. Whether that is energy or matter. So reality, the ultimate reality, is free from birth and death. And if birth and death is not there, being and non-being are just ideas. Because we think that to be born means from non-being we come to the realm of being. And that is why removing notions is the task of meditation practitioner. We suffer because of these notions. Fear, anger, despair, anxiety are all born from notions. And the 15th exercise of mindful breathing is to contemplate nirvana. Nirvana is the absence of all notions. Nirvana is the nature of no birth, no death, no coming, no going, no sameness, no otherness. And that the true nature of reality. Nirvana, the word Nirvana came from the popular language. They speak it in the countryside. It means in the popular talking, Nirvana means extinction of fire. The people cook their meal and overnight the fire dies down slowly, and in the morning when they come and break and make breakfast, they touch the ash and they see very, very fresh, very cool, very calm. There's no fire going on. So Nirvana is state of extinction of all fire of afflictions. It's very pleasant state of reality. Fear, anger, jealousy, despair are all the fire that is burning. And Nirvana is the extinction of these kind of flames, a state of coolness. Very pleasant. And that is the nature of no birth, no death, no coming, no going. That is at the base of our manifestation. Remember the image of the wave. The wave suffers because she believes that she has a beginning, she has an end. She has to go up, but she has to go down. She is there, but the next moment she will not be there. So she's caught in ideas like beginning, ending, going up, going down, being there or not being there. And if the wave wants to stop all this suffering, she has to bend down and touch her nature, her true nature, which is water. And the moment when the wave realizes she is water, she loses all fear. She knows that she has no beginning, no end, no coming up, no going down, no this, no the other. And when she touches her true nature as water, she enjoys going up, she enjoys going down. So it is possible with deep looking, we touch our true nature of no coming, no going, no birth, no death, no being, no non-being, no sameness, no otherness. And that is the removal of all notions. And the Diamond Sutra recommend only the removal of four notions. That's enough. So Nirvana is coolness, very pleasant. And when we touch our true nature of no birth, no death, we touch Nirvana, and that is absolute peace and happiness. And Nirvana is available in the here and the now. You don't have to look for it elsewhere and in the future. It's like the water. The wave doesn't have to go and look for water. She is water right in here and now. If she gets enlightened, and then she is water. The same is true with us. We don't have to go to look for salvation, for liberation somewhere else. We don't have to go and look for nirvana somewhere else. We are in nirvana now. Nirvana is the ground of all manifestation. And it's possible for us to enjoy nirvana in the here and the now. In a sutra called Dhammapada, the Buddha said, the deers, they enjoy the countryside, the forest. The birds, they enjoy going back to the sky. And the wise people, they like to go back to nirvana, in the here and the now. You can understand the expression resting in God the same way. God is the nature of no birth, no death, no coming, no going. And it's possible to touch the ultimate reality as God and lose all your fear. Resting in God is touching nirvana. To me, it's the same thing. But you should know the way. The practice in order to rest in God or to touch nirvana. And not we are not satisfied with just talking about nirvana or resting in God. We should know how to do that in our daily life. So in the Sutra of Nirvana, it is said that the deers enjoy the forest and the countryside. The birds like to go back to the empty sky. And wise people, they enjoy nirvana. And nirvana is available in the here and the now. And that is why you do not have to look for it somewhere else. Everything is perfect in the here and the now. Aimlessness, apranihita, means you don't put in front of you an object and run after it. Whether that object is Buddhahood or the Kingdom of God. Because that is already there in yourself. You just go home and you touch it. Aimlessness. Until you feel that you are already what you want to become. That until you realize that this is it. You don't have true happiness and peace. So this is it, is another way of saying aimlessness. You don't run after anything else. Everything is already there, including the Kingdom of God, including Nirvana. The 14th is contemplating non-craving. We crave for power. We crave for wealth. We crave for fame, we crave for sensual pleasures. Because we believe that these will make us happy. And we should look around to see the people who run after these objects of craving. Fame, recognition, power, sensual pleasures, and many of them suffer so deeply. And even have to commit suicide. They destroy their body and their mind just because they run too hard after these objects of craving. And how much power do you need to be happy? How much fame do you need to be happy? The flower there, does she need some recognition to be happy? Does she need some more power to be happy? Many young people think that President Obama, the President of the United States, has a lot of power. But go and ask the President whether he has enough power. He will tell you that his power is nothing. He needs much, much more power, and we don't know how much power more that he needs. He feels very powerless, I'm sure. There are many things he wants to do, but he is not capable of doing that. And yet he is considered to be the person who has the greatest power on earth. And the Buddha advised us to look deeply to see the danger in the object of our craving. It's like a bait fishermen use in order to fish. The bait may look very attractive, and the fish is tempted to bite. But if the fish is aware that there is a hook inside, she will never bait, and she will never hook up and die. So as good practitioners, we have to look at the object of our craving and see the danger, the hook in it. And we can enjoy being happy in the here and the now with the conditions of happiness that we already have. We have more than enough conditions to be happy. We are so lucky than many people. And if we are happy, we can help them, those who are not as lucky as us, and become a bodhisattva. And we do not need to have a lot of money, a lot of power in order to do that. We need only to be happy and to be compassionate, and we can do so much in order to help other people. And the 16, which is the last exercise on mindful breathing, is contemplating letting go. The teaching is methodically offered by the Buddha. In order to touch our true nature of no birth, no death, to enjoy nirvana, to enjoy freedom, we have to know how to give up and letting go, contemplating letting go. First of all, our ideas, our notions. Many of us suffer because our ideas, our notions. We have a notion about happiness. We are caught by notion, and we are not able to touch all the wonders of life that are available in the here and the now. People around us seem to be very happy, they enjoy it, but because we are caught by an idea, we are kept in our sorrow, our anger, and we cannot get in touch with the wonders of life that are available in the here and now. We cannot get in touch with the sun, the moon, the beautiful planet. We are losing our time. Every moment can be a moment of happiness, of joy, of celebration. And we are caught by our idea and our notions that give us fear, anger, despair. That is why it's very important to contemplate letting go of ideas and notions. We should study the text of the sutra on mindful breathing and explore more about the teaching. The teaching and the practice of mindful breathing take care of everything, our body, our feeling, our mental formations, and our notions and ideas. Learning the saying the sutra on mindful breathing, we know that a good practitioner has to learn how to handle happiness and how to handle suffering. That is an art. Meditation is not hard labor. Meditation needs a lot of skillfulness, because that is an art. If you don't know how to handle happiness, happiness will turn into something else very soon. The love that you experience in the beginning is so beautiful. And you believe that without that love, you cannot survive. But if you don't know the art of nourishing love, it will die and turn into something else, sour. The Buddha said, nothing can survive without food. Your love needs food. You have to feed your love properly. And if you are mindful, concentrated, you will cherish what you are having now, your love. We have to be very attentive. We have to cherish every moment of our being together. We have to learn how to feed our love. And if by mistake, our love has turned into something else, less than love, we should not be despaired. Because we know that love is made of non-love elements. A lotus is made of non-lotus elements, including the mud. So with skillfulness, we can make good use of the mud in order to cultivate lotus again. A good organic gardener never throw away the garbage. She knows how to preserve the garbage in order to make compost and nourish future flowers. Suffering and happiness are also of organic nature. If by chance happiness has become suffering, let us not despair. With our skillfulness, our practice, we can transform suffering back into happiness. We can make good use of the mud in order to create lotus flower. We should learn from the suffering. And suffering can instruct us. Don't try to run away from suffering. The first teaching of the Buddha is about the Four Noble Truths and begins with ill being, suffering. If we try to run away from it, we have no chance to understand the nature of suffering, and we don't know how to create happiness. In order to know how to create happiness, you have to understand suffering, the nature of suffering. And that is why there is an art of handling happiness, but there is an art of handling suffering. The art to suffer should be the title of my next book. Or please write it for me. We have already the art of happiness, I think written by the Dalai Lama. We need another book, The Art of Suffering. If you know how to suffer, you don't suffer much. And you can make good use of the suffering in order to create happiness. In fact, we can learn a lot from our suffering. We know that understanding of suffering gives rise to understand to compassion. And compassion is a very important element of happiness. Without compassion in us, we cannot be a happy person. We are utterly alone, cut off. We cannot relate to any other living beings. That is why compassion is very crucial for happiness. And in order for compassion to arise, you have to dig into the nature of suffering. Understanding suffering will bring about compassion. And that is why the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of God, there is suffering. Without the element of suffering, you have no hope to create understanding and compassion. If you want to grow lotus, you need the mud. So it's natural that there is suffering in the kingdom of God. But in the kingdom of God, people know how to make good use of the suffering and do not let suffering overwhelm us. And we have to participate in the work of building the kingdom by practicing, by learning how to make good use of suffering in order to create happiness. And if happiness deteriorates, we know how to restore it by the practice of using suffering. This is because this is the teaching of the Buddha. It's very simple, but it's very deep. This is because that is. Nhược thư hữu, tất bi hữu. This is because that is. It means if birth is there, death should be there. If right is there, left is there. If being there, non-being is there. So these pairs of opposites, they always manifest at the same time. That is on the level of the conventional truth. But if we get deeper, we transcend conventional truth, and we find out the ultimate truth, where there is no birth, no death, no being, no non-being. I think science is experimenting the same kind of thing. Classical science, represented by Newton, is something like on the conventional truth. It can be applied, yes. But when it comes to quantum mechanics, we see things quite differently. Time, space, matter, energy, particle, wave, they don't seem to be different things. They are very much the same thing. So it is possible that scientists and Buddhist practitioners can work together in this century, and they can help each other. Our suffering, our depression, if they continue, because we keep feeding them, looking deeply into the nature of compassion, of our depression, we know that we have been feeding our depression. If our depression has not gone away, because we still keep feeding it. The Buddha said nothing can survive without food. Your love without food will die. Your depression also. If you stop feeding it, it will die also. And the Buddha advised us to look at things, at the roots of things, in terms of nutriment. In the past many months, you have lived and consumed in such a way that your depression has become a reality. There is a famous saying of the Buddha on this matter. What has come to be? What has come to establish itself? It means your suffering. If you know how to look deeply into it and discover the nutrients that have let it in, you are already on the path of liberation. So to recognize the kind of nutriment that is that has been used to feed our ill-being is the first step. And when we have recognized the source of food, the source of nutriment we use to feed our suffering, our depression, we just stop, cut off that source, and our depression, our ill-being will have to die. This is the teaching of the Buddha on healing. And the Buddha said, there is suffering in us, and we usually blame on the outside, on the environment, on other people. And we think that the other person is enemy number one, our enemy number one. The Buddha said, looking deeply, we'll find out that the enemy number one is ourselves. It is ourselves who make ourselves suffer the most. The way we consume, the way we look for happiness, the way we eat, the way we drink, the way we organize our life, the way we look for happiness, the way we behave, the suffering that we undergo has been created mostly by us. We are the worst enemy of ourselves. That's what the Buddha said. We are responsible for our own suffering. Do not blame on the suffering. Do not blame on another person outside of you for your suffering. You are the author, the main author of your suffering. You are enemy number one. The enemy number one. Your enemy number one is you. And that is why looking into the heart of suffering, we can identify the source of nutriment. We have ills to feed it. We might have thought that this is good for us, but so far it has made us suffer a lot. And once we have recognized the source of nutriment for our ill-being, we just cut it, and our suffering will have to die. And this can be done together as a Sangha. In the tradition, we practice always with the Sangha, whether that is the practice of sitting or walking. We can always make good use of the collective energy of Sangha. And the Sangha can offer us shining light and support us. And the Sangha may advise us on the roots of our own suffering and how to stop feeding our suffering. And that is why taking refuge in the Sangha is not a profession. A declaration of faith, but it is a practice. We can do that together. We can meditate together. We may discover the source of suffering together. And we may support each other in cutting off that source of nutriment that has brought suffering to us. And we may cultivate the lotus together. We may help each other to handle the mud in such a way that we can produce beautiful lotus. And we do not discriminate against the mud, the suffering anymore. Instead, we know how to learn from it and how to make good use of it. The path of the Buddha is the path we call the middle way. The middle way is the way transcending pairs of opposite. It's not caught either by the notion of birth and death, being and non-being, and so on. As a Sangha, we have to offer opportunities for many other people to come and practice and transform. And each of us should be a continuation of the Buddha, because we are cells in a Buddha body. We know that individual cells in our body practice cellular respiration and produce energy to nourish the body. So we practice mindfulness, concentration, and insight as energy to nourish our Sangha and to provide people around us with a refuge. And let us look for ways to contribute to the work of the Buddha, of the Sangha. Let us become a good Dharma brother, a good Dharma sister to the people who want to come and practice. We need many more Dharma teachers. Lay and monastic to organize, to provide people with this kind of environment so that they can come and have a chance to look back and practice and transform. We need thousands and thousands of Dharma workers, Dharma teachers, lay and monastic. So you are invited to join us to continue the career of the Buddha. You practice the 5 mindfulness training. You practice the 14 mindfulness training. You are Bodhisattvas on the path. and compassion, enlightenment in us, produced by the practice, will be the energy that can help us support the practice of many people who desperately need help and practice. The children are back with us. Let us sing together a song to conclude this retreat. The children have received the two promises, have made the two promises, and become practitioners. We invite the monastic and members of the OI to come, and the children, let us sing together a song and offer our gratitude to the three jewels that have supported us in making this retreat a very happy event in our life. Please, when you go home, organize the practice for your family, for your friends, and continue the work of the Buddha. Build a Sangha. I think this practice center has to offer 4 or 5 retreats a year like this. And you should come and help, because many people want the practice.
Hello. It's on here, but I don't know if there is. It's on. Yeah. You here, but there, I don't know if here. Dear friends, there are a number of books. You asked Thay to sign. It's already signed here on the podium. You will come and take later. Okay.
No coming, no going, no after. I release you to be so free, because I am in you.